of all, I thank Principal Sir Mohammed Iqbal and HOD Saeed Sir and my friend Dinesh for this inviting me to this wonderful seminar. And actually, it's a great honor for me to present at this webinar in Vadi Huda Institute. It's one of the premier and emerging institute in Kerala. So especially this special occasion where the inauguration of the new chemistry lab. So actually, I had opportunity to see some of the photographs of the new lab, Doctor. In fact, Dr. Dinesh sent some of the pictures, and actually, it looks really good. And with its spacious, brand new lab with all facilities, actually, I congratulate the management and faculties for providing this kind of high-class facilities to the students. And these kind of things definitely help students, especially to develop some interest in the field. Also, that will eventually help to like pursue their career in this field. So that's really good. And with that, we can move to the presentation. Let me share my screen. I think host disabled screen sharing. Can you please enable it? Hope some technical issues.
Sir, please wait.
Yeah, okay, sure, no problem. Yeah, now I can do that. Thank you. Can you see my slides?
Yes, sir.
Oh, yeah, okay, good. Okay, let me take the pointer. Yeah, so today, actually, I'll be talking about 2D nanomaterials. Sorry about that. Yeah. Today, I'll be talking about 2D nanomaterials, and this will be a very basic talk. So basically, I'll be giving some overview of 2D nanomaterials and various type of 2D nanomaterials, especially graphene and some other 2D nanomaterials, and how to synthesize that and how you can characterize these kind of nanomaterials, and how I use these kind of some of my research work where I used these kind of materials for some biomedical applications. So I will give an overview of these kind of things in this talk. Okay. Yeah, so let's start from the basics. Okay, so what are nanomaterials? So in this figure right here, you can see this figure where this shows the distribution of materials based on their sizes. This shows the scale of like sizes of different types of materials. So as you know, if a particle of size having a size range of like 100 micrometer or more, that we call as micrometeorials. You can just classify based on these sizes, like micrometeorials. Micrometeorials are the materials where you can see with your naked eyes, okay? Then there are a class of materials. If you take the sizes from 100 nanometer to 100 micrometer, that size range, particular size range, we call as micrometeorials. And you can consider size of bacteria, size of red blood cells, all these things comes in this size range, okay? And these things you can't see with your naked eyes, but you can use some microscope, optical microscope to see particles in this particular size range, okay? Then comes the another range where the size of particle is somewhere around 1 nanometer to 100 nanometer. This particular size range is called nanomaterials, or the particles within that size range we call as nanomaterials, okay? And there are a lot of examples for these type of materials. Okay, so I will come to that. So today we'll be talking about different types of nanomaterials and their applications, right? So I'll talk more about these type of materials. Okay, and there are smaller particles, even lesser than that. Like if the particle size is less than 1 nanometer, we can call those, classify these materials as sub-nanometer materials. Okay, if you consider a size of atom that is less than 1 nanometer, right? So, or small molecules, all these comes smaller range, okay? So we are just focusing on the materials with sizes ranging from 1 nanometer to 100 nanometer. Okay, actually why these materials are so important. So if you consider particles in this particular size range, usually it shows exciting physical and chemical properties compared to their bulk part. Okay, that's why these type of materials have been used for various applications. There's a lot of research is going on in this field for making different types of material using this particular range. Okay, so that is the definition for a nanomaterial. Okay, so a nanomaterial is a material which having a size range, at least one dimension should be in 1 to 100 nanometer size, okay? So how you can classify these type of different nanomaterials based on their dimensionality? And this is the main classification we do usually. So, and based on the dimensionality, you can classify these nanomaterials as zero dimensional, one dimensional, two dimensional, three dimensional nanomaterials, okay? So these namings comes from, you just see the length, width and height of the nanomaterial. Okay, so you can take the X, Y, Z axis lengths or width or height of the nanomaterial. If all comes within the nano range, okay, so then you can say there is no dimension is above nano range. So that's why it's called zero dimensional. Okay, such type of materials we can classify as zero dimensional nanomaterials. So you can take X, Y, Z direction, like height, width or length of this material within the nano range. So examples for these type of materials are gold nanoparticles. Usually you can consider all metal nanoparticles or quantum dots, fullerene, all these materials, nanomaterials comes in zero dimensional nanoparticles. Okay, then there is another category called one dimensional nanomaterial. So here two dimensions are within nano range, but one dimension is above nano range, okay? So here you can see the width and height still within the nano range, but length is above nano range. It's, you can consider maybe it's micrometer or centimeter length, okay, whatever it is. So you can call such type of material as one dimensional nanomaterial. Examples for these materials are like, you might have heard of carbon nanotubes, then metal nanowires, all this comes under one dimensional nanomaterials, okay? But why is still nano range? Usually these materials are called nanomaterials. So you can say these are ultra thin nanomaterials with, usually its height is like one or a few molecule width. That means its height is within the nano range. Okay, so in this talk, I'll be talking more about this 2D, different types of 2D layered nanomaterials, okay? Then there is another class called 3D nanomaterials, where the length width and height both are in the out of nano range. Okay, but still it shows some different exciting properties. And some examples are liposomes and some polycrystalline, some polymeric nanomaterials and dendrimers. All these can classify as three-dimensional nanomaterials. Okay, these are the classification of nanomaterials based on dimensionality. So today this talk, I'll be more focusing on the 2D nanomaterials. These are recently like recent nanomaterials, and it's a kind of emerging nanomaterial class of nanomaterials. And compared to other nanomaterials, you know a lot of properties of metal nanoparticles or metal nanowires already, but these are recently new type of nanomaterials. Okay, I'll tell you why this is important. So 2D nanomaterials, you can define like 2D nanomaterials are crystalline nanomaterials consisting of single layer of atoms of molecules. So because it is ultra thin, okay, its thickness is usually you can say less than 1 nanometer, sometimes it's a few nanometers in thickness. Okay, so if you classify 2D nanomaterials, the initially studied and most studied material is called the graphene. We'll come to this. And there are different other type of nanomaterials. Recently, people are researching on various type of other nanomaterials, boron nitride, magnesium diboride, and there are other nanomaterials also. So usually you can classify 2D nanomaterials as graphene, like graphene, and its analogs. It can be inorganic analogs like MOST or other material, or it can be a doped form or modified form of graphene. So this is the main classification of 2D nanomaterial. So before going to the carbon-based 2D nanomaterial, I'll just introduce different carbon forms. So this, you know this well, what are the naturally occurring forms of carbon, right? In the pure form of carbon, we seen in mainly in these two forms. One is called diamond and another one is graphite. And you know the difference between these two materials, right? One is naturally non-hardest hard material, whereas other one is used as a solid lubricant. Okay, so you know what, why these materials two, both are carbons, pure form of carbons, but both behaves totally different in terms of its properties, right? So, and you know why? Because in diamond, you have sp3 hybridization, right? Because each carbon is attached to another 4 carbon. It's a highly crystalline form, okay? So it forms a transparent, highly crystalline arrangement. It's a hard material. Whereas if you see the graphite, it has carbon is having sp2 hybridization, and each carbon atom is attached to another 3 carbon atoms. And it forms a like hexagonal arrangement. It's a honeycomb hexagonal lattice. And these different forms, like these are stacked together. Okay, and you have one layer of carbon atoms. Again, you have another layer of carbon atoms. Actually, this is very easy to slip. That's why it can be used as a solid lubricant. Okay, and this property is totally different. You know, there is no conductivity. These are best insulator, but whereas in graphite, that can actually conduct electricity because you have a lone pair of electrons on each carbon atom. So it can be localized all over the plane. So it's a conducting material, whereas it's an insulating material. Okay, a lot of different properties just based on the bonds. Anyway, and this is not the only 2 items, and you have other things like pure forms of carbon can be seen as a 660 fullerene, and there are carbon nanotubes, and these 2 materials are widely used for various applications. Okay, so well studied, and it can be used in various different applications. But the fate of carbon materials really changed when these 2 guys, like you know, Andre Geim and Novoselov, these 2 scientists from University of Manchester, they actually made a very important discovery back in 2004. Okay, so what they did is they took graphite, already mentioned you, like you have a different stacked layers of carbon atoms, okay, sp2 bonded carbon atoms. So what they did is in one experiment, actually they used a simple scotch tape, that is just sellotape you can say, or a sticky tape. So they used this tape, and they peeled a single layer of a single layer from a multi-layered graphite structure. Okay, so and isolated that single layer and they studied it, and it showed properties. Okay, so you can say this material, so that is a single layer they peeled off from a multi-layer graphene structure, graphite structure. So this material is called graphene. So graphene, theory of graphene come to the physical properties of this material. Okay, it shows very exciting properties like electronic and some metallic, very good properties. So because of that, they have showed some of these properties, and soon after the discovery of this wonderful material, and the potential of this material, and they awarded Nobel Prize in Physics 2010. Soon after, when they received Nobel Prize, people started working on this. Okay, now you can say thousands of scientists around the globe is working on this wonderful material for like various applications. You can say from biomedical applications or material applications or various applications. Okay, so this material can be used for various applications just because of this wonderful properties. Okay, and this table will tell you why this material is that important. Okay, here you can see its charge carrier mobility. It has got very high charge carrier mobility. This is higher than non-metal conductors. Okay, and it has got very thermal conductivity also. So it has very high charge carrier mobility. That shows that electron can freely flow on the surface of these graphene sheets. Okay, so that's very good, because if you think about any type of electronic things, what you need is like less resistance. If you have this type of material, it can be utilized in various electronic applications. Okay, then it has got very high thermal conductivity. It has got very high transparency. That means transparency is almost 97.4%. That means light, it won't absorb any light. It absorbs very small percentage of light, and you can think about like some transparent displays. Okay, so that it will be like, ideally it will be highly transparent. So you can think about some such kind of displays or electronic devices which are like highly transparent using these type of materials. Okay, then some projected things are like, there are a lot of projected applications for this material. I will come to some of these applications. Okay, and another thing is it's very high surface area. So you can say 1 square meter of graphene, actually it weighs only 0.77 milligrams. So you can just imagine how lightweight it is. But again, it's a hypothetical situation. You can't make very high surface area graphene as of now. It's very hard to synthesize such a high surface area material. That's one of the obstacles scientists are facing nowadays for real life applications of these materials. Okay. Then another thing is it's Young's modulus, and this cartoon which represents the strength of the material. So this is estimated that its strength is almost 200 times stronger than steel. Okay, this cartoon actually represents that. Like if you want to tear a graphene sheet, you need this much force, like an elephant, the weight of an elephant on a pencil tip. That just shows the strength of this material. Okay, so you need that much like force to tear a graphene sheet. And also you might have seen some pictures where like a bullet can be stopped using these type of materials. Okay, these are all are like projected applications of these materials. Then another thing is it's has got very tensile strength. Okay, that what does that means is like it can be stretched, or like you can change its length like 20% length without breaking. That means again, like some, it has got a lot of project applications. You can think about flexible displays, and the display you can bend it, stretch it, and number of times so that it won't break. There are a lot of research is going on in this field. You know that there are some flexible displays or then this type of devices are already in the market, but it is not based on graphene, but mainly it's based on oily material. Okay, so and some of them hopefully it will come in the future, this type of things. Okay, Okay, then what are the different types of graphenes? So for different applications, you need a different variety of graphenes, right? So we have a pure graphene. So that is called a pristine graphene sheet. Okay, then there is an oxidized form that is usually it's called a graphene oxide. That is nothing but if you just oxidize this material, you will have some oxidized like oxygen functionalities on the surface. So this is called material is called graphene oxide. So here the importance of this material is if you introduce the oxygen functionalities on the surface of graphene, you are actually losing the conductivity of this material because you are introducing some like defects on the planes. But same time, you will get very good solubility in water. So particularly if you are using for biomedical applications, you need to inject into the body, you need some water soluble system, right? So for such applications, you can use this material. Okay, so here solubility can be enhanced. And you have you can reduce this material. If you reduce this, you can still get some of the double bonds back. So that material is called reduced graphene oxide. Here you will get the conductivity a little bit back, but same time you will have some oxygen functionalities. And again, you can like modulate its solubility, and that's called as reduced graphene oxide. Okay, then another form of graphene is graphene conondoids. So here, this is actually the small, the graphene is actually, you can think about a large sheet. And if you make it small pieces of graphene, like say it's a length and width, you can like reduce by in the nano range, less than 100 or 50 nanometers. So that small pieces of graphene, it's called graphene condon dots. Okay, it's just like condon dots. Like you have the main property is if you radiate with some light and you will get the lights back like in different wavelength. This is called fluorescence. You are aware of fluorescence, right? So these are fluorescent materials. You have a specific band gap here. So if you excite with suitable radiation, you can have suitable emissions for these materials. Okay, so this has got some other applications, like if you want like biosensing or some fluorescence based applications, you can use this material. So these are the widely used forms of graphene. Okay, then actually if you talk about 2D nanomaterials, it's initially studied graphene and most explored nanomaterial is graphene, of course, but there are other type of materials. So soon after the discovery of graphene, people were like searching what are the like similar materials that are available like graphene. So there are different other materials, like this is one best example is MOS2, that is transition metal dichalcogenides. So there are class of materials you can think about, like these are almost similar to graphite. These are layered structures. Then people started separating the mono layers and studied its properties. So again, this also just like graphite, these sort of materials, when it comes to the single layer, just like graphene, you can say it also has some exciting properties. So people have started investigating on that. And other 2D nanomaterials are like some, there are some oxides like vanadium monoxide and other materials are there. Then phosphorines are there, like different forms of phosphorus. Then hydroxides are also available. Best example is magnesium hydroxide is there. Then MXenes are there. And there are a lot of other layered materials that are available right now. And some of them are showing really exciting properties. Okay, then now I will show you how to synthesize these type of nanomaterials. Okay, start with the graphene. And there are two ways to make it. Okay, first way is like any nanomaterial you can synthesize in two ways. One approach is a top-down approach. You are starting from the like bulk counterpart and you are coming to the smaller ones. Okay, then there is another way is bottom-up approach. Okay, and in top-down approach, basically, you are starting from graphite. Okay, if you want to get graphene, you have to start with the graphite. And here, this is the original method that actually led to the discovery of this material. Okay, this is the easiest method. Actually, you can also try in home. And what you need is graphite. Anyway, you have pencil, right? So you have source of graphite. So take or scribble something on the table or something, then use the scotch tape or normal sellotape and use that. So what you are doing basically is just if you do once, you are getting like a multi-layered graphite in your hand. Okay, so you continue the process. Okay, you can repeat this process like many times and until you reach a point where you are able to get a single layer of graphene. Okay, so actually this is the, like you can say, this is the most effective way of isolating high quality graphene in small amounts. Okay, but if you want to, this is for laboratory purpose, it's fine. If you want to study the properties, that's what they did. Andre Gehman and Oslo, what they did is they used this technique and they like isolated a single sheet. Okay, and also it's, there's a problem with this technique. Even if you get a single layer of graphene on your scotch tape, you need to separate it for studying, right? So that's, again, it takes, it's not that easy to get, separate this single layer of graphene on the adhesive material. Okay, you have to use some solvent like acetone or something. Like you can dissolve the adhesive, then you can take the graphene sheet, like it's, it will be really small. So you can separate it anyway, and you can study its properties, like physical properties and all. So for laboratory purpose, you can do this, and you can make small amount of graphene using this technique, and the quality of graphene should, will be really good by this technique. Okay, but this is not sufficient for, if you think about some various other applications, like if you want to use for like a large scale application, definitely you have to follow some different techniques. Okay, so this is another best way to do that. Okay, all you need is this instrument. So this is a common instrument, it's called a ultrasonicator. Okay, so this ultrasonicator is a small device with, it has a probe there. So that probe is actually like, it's a piezoelectric material that can vibrate at very high frequency. Usually frequencies are like beyond our hearing limit, like greater than 20 kilohertz. Okay, that's why it's called ultrasonicator. So if it vibrates at very high frequency, usually it makes micro bubbles in solution. To like, if you have a water or any solution, and if you have graphite there, okay, then you add some surfactant, then you do the sonication. Okay, the vibration will create micro bubbles in solution. That micro bubbles will break, and that energy can be used for like separating. It's like exfoliating different layers into the solution. Okay, finally you will end up with, you can continue this for some time, and finally you will end up with single sheets of graphene in solution. You can use some centrifuging technique to separate these monolayers, and finally you are getting graphene in your hand. Okay, and that's a very good technique to make graphene in large scale. It's a very easy to do in laboratory conditions. Okay, and you can use different solvents. You don't have to use the surfactants. Instead, you can use this small molecule like this is a molecule called NMP, N-methyl pyrrolidine. Okay, you can use, this is a very good solvent. And if you add this in the graphite into the NMP and sonicate it for like, even for just 30 minutes is enough to get good quality graphene sheets. And if you continue for a long time, that can create some defects on the graphene planes. So that's possible. And it's actually, it depends. If you can control this sonication time and the solvent system to get the control the quality of the graphene sheets. Okay, so this is another way to make it. Okay, this is not limited to graphene, and you can use the same technique for other 2D nanomaterial like MOS2. And here, this bulk MOS2 is just like graphite, it's layered structures. And best way is to add lithium ions. Lithium, you know, it's a small, very small ions. And if you add lithium ions, it can actually intercalate into the different layers of MOS2. And if you have a sonicator or something, small sonicator system, then that's enough to take these different sheets into the solution. And you'll be getting like mono layers of MOS2. Okay. And if you really want to make small MOS2, just like I mentioned the graphene condensates, just like you can make MOS2 condensates. So what you have to do is you have to continue this technique. And finally, you will end up with a small like condon dots that will have some emission properties. So it will, like, solutions will look like this. Okay, some clear solution you will get, and you can separate and use for the desired applications. Okay, so this is the top-down approach, liquid phase exfoliation technique for MOS2. And this is another important technique to make graphene oxide. Okay, this is the oxidized form of graphene. Already I told you about the graphene oxide. So This also you can do it at lab. Okay, what you need is just sulfuric acid and KM for this common oxidizing system, right? So what you have to do is just take graphite and add this reagents, that is KM4 and sulfuric acid, and this method is known as Hummer's method. And so what you will get is, like, you will have different oxygen functionalities on the different layers. So you will have epoxide, and you will have hydroxyl group and carboxylic acid groups on various places. Okay, so this material, the oxidized form of graphite, we call it a graphite oxide. So take this graphite oxide and do the ultrasonication in water. Okay, do it for some time. Then you can, like, separate each individual layers into the solution. Finally, you will end up with some clear solution. So that is the called graphene oxide. So this is not a pristine graphene, it's oxidized form. Okay, it has got various applications. I will show you some of the applications of these materials later in this presentation. Okay, another ways, if you want to make precise graphene sheets, another way to do is use the same oxidation technique in carbon nanotubes. Okay, carbon nanotube is a tube-like structure. So take the carbon nanotube, apply this chemistry. So you have to carefully set the conditions of the same oxidation technique. So this technique actually eventually lead to the formation of graphene. So what it does is the same oxidation on the double bonds of this carbon nanotubes. And finally, you will get a unzipped form. Okay, so in this way, you can make, this is the images of the unzipped CNTs. And this way also you can make graphenes in, like, precise manner. And actually I was talking about the top-down approaches, right? So this is another bottom-up approach to make 2D nanomaterials. So in this is actually one hydrothermal method for the synthesis of MOS2 nanosheets. And here actually you are starting from the precursor, like you need some salts which contain molybdenum as well as sulfur. Okay, you need the sources of molybdenum and sulfur. So you mix all these reagents together, and you have to use a autoclave. It's a technique where you have to apply very high like temperature and pressure. Usually its temperature is about 220 degrees Celsius, and inside it will generate very high pressure. At that conditions, usually it forms. This individual molybdenum and sulfur will join to form this molybdenum MOS2 nanosheets. Okay, so, and you can use this for even graphene also. Like there are many reports where natural sources are used for making some derivatives of graphene. There are ways, but the quality of the sheet won't be that good compared to other techniques. So that is not a recommended method for a synthesis of high quality graphene, but this is can be used for the synthesis of MOS2 nanosheets. So this is a one of bottom-up approach. Okay, and this is another approach, and this is called CVD, or chemical vapor deposition. Okay, and this is the, you can say in industries and all, they use normally this technique to make high quality graphene. This is another bottom-up approach. Here you need to start with some carbon precursor. Okay, here usually we use the carbon source as methane, and in some an inert atmosphere at a very high temperature, usually like 800 to 1000 degrees Celsius, and they use a copper foil, copper or nickel foil. Okay, so this individual carbon atoms from this will actually, like, from the carbon atoms from the methane can join together to form. There are different mechanisms are explained, like how these graphene sheets are formed. So basically it's starting from a single individual carbon atom. So it's joined to form very high, like high surface area graphene sheets can be synthesized by this technique. So if you want to, so this actually CVD can yield high quality graphene. So the advantage here is you will get high pure graphene, and you can actually will have some control over the layer number, like monolayer or bilayer or trilayer. Actually, you will have some control by changing different conditions. So this is one of the hurdles which scientists face nowadays to make these graphene sheets. By using this technique, millimeter to centimeter sized graphene sheets can be achieved. But again, if you are, like, we are talking about some very large displays or something, then you need very high surface area graphene. Synthesis is not that easy. There are some claims that a centimeter to like few centimeter size graphene sheets are formed by this technique. And yeah, still scientists are working to how to tackle this issue. But still, if you are looking for some various other applications, not the display applications or high surface area applications, still these all techniques works well, and you can make graphene sheets of very high purity using all these techniques. Okay, so you know how to make graphene, right? So there are different ways you can make it. Okay, once you have this type of material, okay, how to characterize this? And if you have some graphene sheets in your hand, but the first thing you have to check is the thickness of the layers. That only can tell you whether you made a graphene or you have a multi-layer or monolayer. Okay, so best way to characterize a graphene sheet is, you can say, like, you can use some imaging technique as well as spectroscopy techniques. So the best imaging technique you can use is AFM. Okay, so it's called atomic force microscope or AFM. AFM instrument will look like this. And the principle of this technique is, principle is actually simple. It's a highly sophisticated technique, but principle I will explain to you. And here, what you have is a small cantilever and a tip is attached to it. Okay, this tip is actually, it's a very few atoms thickness tip. And what you are doing is, if you have some samples, and you will scan this tip on the surface. Okay, so based on the force law, if you have something on the surface of the sample, so it will have some force, right? So there will be some deflection on the cantilever, and a laser is attached to that, and the deflection can be detected on the photodetector. Okay, based on the deflection, you can get the, I have one image. Let me see. I think it's not working. Leave it. Okay. Anyway, this is just like here. If you have some sample, and if a sample has some material on the surface, so it will have some deflection, and that deflection can be like detected in the photodetector. Okay. Nothing like that's a very simple technique. And the advantage here is you can see these are some AFM images of some graphene sheets. You can see the sheets, right? So from this sheet, you can precisely measure the thickness of the sheet. If the size, the height of the sheet is below one nanometer or less than that, you can say you have synthesized a monolayer of graphene. Okay. And if it is like, say it's 2 or 3 nanometer, definitely you can say you have 2 or 3 layers stacked together. Okay. So this way you can characterize synthesized graphene, a type of any 2D nanomaterials using this technique. Okay. Yeah. Another important technique is called TEM. You might have seen TEM images. This is a very big instrument. Okay. So a TEM instrument will look like this. This is called a transmission electron microscope. Here also principle is, it is actually similar to an optical microscope. Okay. So you know how an optical microscope work, right? So instead of visible light, you are using electron beam. So, and for optical light, visible light, you have like lenses, optical lenses to converge or diverge the radiations, right? So here you use, instead of optical lenses, you have magnetic lenses. Okay, you're applying magnetic field to converge or diverge the electron beam. So you will keep the sample somewhere here, and you will just irradiate your electron beam to that. It's a focused beam. Okay, so, and you will observe the shadow of the whatever the material you have on the photographic plane over here. Okay, so these are the some examples of TEM images of these materials. These are, you can see, as you can see, it's like transparent sheets can be seen on a TEM image. Okay, but you can't measure the thickness of the sheet, but from the look, you can say how many layers are there, like it's overlapped or not. Okay. So in that way, you can measure the thickness, but you can measure the thickness, but you can like identify, you can get a qualitative idea whether your sample is pure or not. Okay, and these are another technique. And if you talk about spectroscopy technique, and Raman spectroscopy is still a important technique, spectroscopy technique to characterize these type of 2D nanomaterials. Okay, and I don't have to explain the Raman effect, right? So you all are familiar with the Raman effect, and a Raman spectroscopy spectrometer is looks like this. Okay, so here what you are doing is you are irradiating your sample, any material. Okay, in Raman spectroscopy, you are irradiating material with a suitable light. Usually you use the visible radiation. Usually it's a laser. Okay, so if you irradiate with any sample, you can expect two type of scattering. So one is like if you radiate any sample with any visible radiation, you will get the same radiation back. So that scattering is called Rayleigh scattering. Say if you irradiate like 100 photons, 99.9 undergo this Rayleigh scattering, but 0.1% will undergo a different type of scattering. That is called actually Raman scattering. That has an energy other than the incident radiation. So from actually the change in energy of this radiation actually comes from the vibrational levels of the molecules. Okay, so the samples will have different types of vibrational modes. So by the absorption of light, it can undergo different types of vibrational excitation. So if you can detect the changes in this energy, so that will corresponding to its vibrational modes. That's what we are measuring in this technique. So from these changes, you will get the different vibrational modes of the sample. Okay, this is the diagram of this material. So you will keep the sample here, irradiate with suitable laser, and you will check for this radiation, like a very small amount of radiation will undergo different scattering. Okay, and from that you are like, you can understand the vibrational modes. So why it is important in case of 2D materials? Okay, this diagram will tell you. Usually these kind of 2D nanomaterials will undergo different types of vibration. Like it can undergo in-plane vibration, it can undergo out-of-plane vibration. Also, if your material has some defects on it, that will have a different types of vibration. Okay. So basically, if you take the Raman spectra, you can find different types of bands. Okay, these are characteristic bands for graphene type of material. So one is G band, that is corresponding to in-plane. Sorry. Any questions?
No, sir, you can continue.
Okay. Thank you. So yeah, here, excuse me. Okay, you can have different types of vibration bands on the graphene sheet. So corresponding to that, you can get different types of bands. These are actually like characteristic to the graphene type of materials. And the one important thing about this spectroscopy is you can actually you can find the quality of the material. Like if you have a few layer, a bilayer, a single layer, actually it will give a different type of spectra. Sorry. So what you have to do is you have to take the ratio of this particular band, G band and 2D band. Okay, so from this, the ratio, you can like find whether you have made a single layer, whether you have a bilayer or you have a few layer graphene sheets. So this is an important technique for finding like different type of graphitic layers. Okay, and yeah, actually I forgot to mention that, you know that Raman got this Nobel Prize in Physics in 1930. And actually we celebrated National Science Day to like in the memory of the day he discovered this technique, right? We celebrated a few days back, like February 28th is the National Science Day, right? So, and I should say this, like nowadays, this Raman spectroscopy is used in not only characterization of these type of nanomaterials, it's used in various other fields. Especially you might have heard of cells technique, that is surface enhanced Raman spectroscopy. Nowadays it's getting more and more importance, especially in the field of biomedical field. And people are using this for detecting cancer and other type of things using various other nanomaterials. Okay, so this technique is so wonderful. And we are using it in various other fields also. Okay, then again, this is the important part for chemists. Okay, so if chemists are always interested to modify the property of these materials for various applications, right? So how to do that? That's very important. So how to modify these type of material for your desired applications. And there are different ways to do that. Okay, so first way is called a non-covalent functionalization technique. That means you are just, it's a simple way of modifying these materials. So if you want to attach, say, some molecules on the surface of graphene, what you have to do is you have to make some aromatic structures. So aromatic structures, usually this graphene you can consider as a polyaromatic surface, right? It's a polyaromatic surface thing. So any polyaromatic material can have interaction with the graphene, like pi stacking interaction. That's a weak interaction, but still molecule can attach on, like through this pi stacking interaction. So if you want to attach some molecules, just attach that molecules to some this kind of aromatic molecules and mix with the graphene. So these structures can sit on the graphene sheet and you will have your material on the surface of graphene. Okay, this is the easiest way to do that. So that is called a non-covalentization technique. Okay, then there is another one, it's a covalent functionalization. Covalent functionalization is it's a bit challenging technique. You have to do some reactions on the graphene sheet. You introduce some molecules on the surface. Okay, and the good thing is you can consider this graphene sheet as like a polyaromatic material. So like any reaction you can work on any aromatic surface, like a benzene, you can try that on the graphene. So you can think about radical addition reactions, carbon reactions, nitrogen reactions, or iron reactions, any type of reactions you can perform on graphene sheet, so that you can attach these various type of molecules on the graphene sheet. And even you can try this Friedel-Crafts acylation reactions, or 1,3 dipolar cyclo addition reactions, or any type of reactions you can perform on graphene sheets. Okay, so in this way, you can modify the property of graphene. Okay, so now you know how to synthesize it, characterize it, and modify this material. Okay, and again, this is not just like graphene. You can use this another important type material, MS material, also for various applications. And how they are doing is, in case of MOS2, chemistry is a bit different, and you have some this type of material. So in that sulfur vacancies, you can add thiols, actually. So that's a very good strategy for functionalizing MOS2 type of material. So thiol can go and sit on the vacancies. So you will have your molecule on the surface of MOS2. And this can be used in like different ways. And also you can add some aromatic molecules. There are reports like aromatic molecules can stay just like graphene on the surface of MOS2 also. So there are different ways you can modify these type of nanomaterials. That's very important for some applications. Okay, then I will discuss some of the real life or electronic or some real life applications of these materials, and some of the projected applications also of these materials in some main thing is like electronic applications. And as I already mentioned, this can be a good substitute for silicon. So the reason is, if you compare graphene and silicon, graphene can conduct almost 50 times better than silicon. And it's if you use this in microprocessors, it will have speed almost 1,000 times better than graphene. And it consumes only 100 times less power. Okay, then another good thing is, it can be a better alternative for brittle ITO. So usually in all touch screens, you have ITO coated on a glass plate. So if you can think about it, like if you just replace this thing with this lightweight material graphene with very good flexibility and strength, and then you can make, like, it's a better alternative. Like, it, then you don't have to worry if you drop your screen. Okay, so, but again, a lot of research is going on in this field. And some of them, there are some prototypes. These all are like some of the prototype devices that scientists are actually working on. And I should mention this graphene flagship. This is actually multi-billion project funded by European Union. And Nokia is one of the partner in this consortium. And like their motto is taking this wonder material from laboratory into the society. So a lot of scientists are working in this field to make different types of flexible graphene transistors and various other electronic devices using these type of graphene nanomaterial. Okay, and this actually news came a week back, and here scientists used these type of chips. They used graphene for chips, and they got almost like 100-fold like better than the silicon chips. So as I said, mentioned, there are a lot of research is going on in this field. And another application is in energy storage application. And energy storage application mainly nowadays in batteries. They are replacing the graphite with these type of 2D nanomaterial like graphene or MOS2 type of material. So the advantage here is you will get very high, higher capacity, and you can achieve very high fast charging. And definitely you can reduce the weight, and you can introduce the flexibility to that because these materials are flexible. And if you think about any devices with flexible displays or something, you need a battery with a flexible property, right? So this can be, again, it's a game changer in that field. And it can withstand very any high temperature range. And some of them are already in the market. And one example is Real Graphene USA. This is a company in US. They introduced this graphene technology in their battery. And you can buy this thing, right, power bank, and they have this technology, and they claim almost 3.5 times faster charging than the existing technology. Okay, and recently Samsung also introduced this graphene based technique, and they call a graphene board. It's a patented technology they used in their recent batteries, and they claim almost 5 times faster charging used this technology. So some of the things are already in the market now. That's good. And another area scientists use this material is in water purification. This is actually a work from Manchester University. So what they used is they used these graphene sheets as a molecular sieve for like making this seawater safe to drink. Okay, and you know the issue, like, almost 844 million people don't have access to clean water. Okay, that means it's almost 13 to 15% of the world population don't have access to clean water. So we should have a very good technology. We have to have a very good technology to purify the seawater, right? So here, this group of scientists from Manchester University, what they used is they used a graphene sheet with some porosity. And first, you should understand this, like graphene can't, it won't pass any atoms, even single hydrogen atom through it. It's actually impermeable to any atoms. But if you introduce some pores that is highly specific to water, like if you can pass water through it, but it can block the other materials, common salts. So then you can make a sieve using this. So this is what they did. They took graphene, they introduced some defects on the surface. They used different techniques like electron beam radiation, UV radiation, and you can try like lithography to introduce some specific defects on the sheets so that it can, it will pass water, but it will block the ions. So they used this for purification technique. And there are some filters are available right now using this technology to purification of water kind of stuff. So this is a very good technology from that. Then another important thing is like, it's nowadays it's used in air filtration technology. So there are some properties which make these materials like highly attractive. One thing is it can show some antibacterial effect. Okay, so, and another property is you can heat it, this material. So if you consider air filtration, like in hospitals and like big air filters, and what you need is you have to apply some temperature to kill these bacteriums and other stuff. So graphene is a perfect material where it shows some antibacterial properties and you can heat it, you can Joule heat it. So that's why they use these technologies in air filtration technique. And also in people are using this even in the mask. So you know how important this is in this pandemic situation. Like this is one mask, it's available in the market where they use some graphene layer in the like filtration. And what they claim is they have filtration efficiency of almost 96.4. You know N95 mask, right? So N95 mask will cut almost 95% of the particulates. So here they achieved even more than that using a graphene layer material in the filter unit. Okay. And people are like using for various real life applications. Yeah, if I talk about commercially, you guys, after completing their graduation, what they did is they just started a nanotechnology startup. It's a Bengaluru based nanotechnology startup. It's called Log9 Materials. And even on Forbes list, actually, is 30 millionaires under 30 years of age. And actually, their story is truly inspiring. You can find their videos on YouTube. I strongly recommend to go and watch those videos. Because how they started is like, they started using these graphene materials on cigarette filters. And graphene has some property. As I mentioned, it can be used as air filters. So they introduced this graphene sheet on the cigarette filters. That's how they started their company. And they are the India's first graphene startup. And they're developing different types of materials. Like they're using graphene in air battery and various introducing this to the lithium battery technique. And like compared to lithium present battery system, and you can reduce cost if you introduce this type of graphene material into the batteries technology. So that's what they are doing. It can be used in electric cars. You know how important it is because Tesla has already started their company in Bangalore. And soon they are planning to have some plants in India. So we should have very good battery technology for these electric cars. So in that way, this is really important. And in 2018, they got some awards from DST India, like most innovative technology award. And if you like, this is the anticipated growth of graphene in Indian market. So it's projected some 38% from 2018 to 2015. So I should say like, there are a lot of potential in this field. So if you guys are really interested in these kind of materials, definitely you should like think about working in this field, or you can do research on this field in the future. And there are a lot of scientists in India. There are a lot of eminent scientists in India are working in this field. And they are also like unveiling different properties of these materials. Okay, so with that applications, I will move to the biomedical applications of these materials. Okay, this is the one area I was interested while I was doing my PhD work. So why these 2D nanomaterials are so important in the field of biomedical applications? Okay, so answer is like due to its some of the good properties of these materials compared to other nanomaterials. One is it has got very high surface area. Okay, then these are like, so if you have very high surface area, you can load different types of drugs for different delivery applications. So that's a good thing. Then it has got a very good biocompatibility. That means it is safe. You can inject to the body. And there are a lot of studies in this field. So it shows that this material is highly biocompatible. Like you can use for drug delivery applications. Okay, then this material can be make water soluble. As I mentioned, like if you think about the oxidized form, that are water soluble. Okay, then you can easily synthesize from cheap precursor. You can start from graphite. That's a common precursor, right? So it's abundant in nature, so it's cheap material. And you can make from that. That's another advantage. Then you can easily functionalize it. Chemical functionalization is possible, and cells can easily take these type of material. Okay, because of these properties, these materials, especially graphene and other 2D nanomaterials, got different applications in biomedical field, especially in the case of bioimaging, especially the quantum dots. It's a fluorescent derivative you can use for bioimaging applications, and these materials can be used for biosensing applications, then different therapeutic applications, drug delivery applications, and there are a lot of applications for this type of materials. Okay. Then, you can see this is the one property of graphene which makes it so attractive in sensing field. So here, what this shows is if you have a DNA, okay, with a fluorophore attached to it, if you add that to the graphene sheet, the good property of graphene is DNA can have very strong interaction on the graphene sheet. And another thing is this graphene sheet will act as a super conjurer for fluorescence. That means if you have a fluorescent molecule, it's close to the graphene surface, fluorescence will go. Like you can say it's a highly fluorescent molecule. Once it's close to graphene, you will get zero fluorescence or nearly zero fluorescence. So it's a fluorescence off state. And if you have some specific strand like DNA, which can interact with this so that you can take this thing from the graphene sheet, you will get the fluorescence back. Okay. So from off state, again, you will get the fluorescence on state. Okay. So this is used in various sensing applications like DNA sensing and other things. And this is not just limited to DNA. You can use various other like proteins or something. So that what you have to do is you have to take the material from the graphene surface, then you will get the fluorescence back. Okay. So this is a very well-known sensing strategy using this type of graphene type materials. Okay, so one work that I have done here is we took graphene oxide, it's the oxidized form of graphene, then we attached a fluorophore. So this is a molecule, it's an naphthenamide molecule with the amine functionality. Okay, so we used some chemistry, some like conjugation chemistry on the surface of graphene so that this molecule is attached on the graphene sheet. Okay, then we characterized using different techniques. And one property of this material is you have different nitrogens on this molecule. Okay, so think about like changing the pH of the media. So at lower pH, like if you lower the pH from 7, these nitrogens can get protonated, and this interaction of this graphene sheet will change. Okay, initially it will have very good strong interaction with graphene sheet. So this fluorophore, that means it gives the fluorescence, and the fluorescence will be in off state. Okay, so once you lower the pH, then this nitrogen will get protonated and the interaction changes, and actually the molecule will prefer the solvent front and it can come out of the system. So you will get the fluorescence back. So that's what we achieved. Like if you start from a lower fluorescence, at the lowering of pH will increase the fluorescence of the system. So basically you have a pH sensing system where you can efficiently sense the pH of the medium. Okay, so where you can use this type of material. So if you look into the body, there is a enzyme called acetylcholine esterase. Okay, this enzyme actually can convert acetylcholine. Acetylcholine is this is a neurotransmitter in our body, and this changes in this acetylcholine leads to various different diseases like Alzheimer's disease. There are a lot of diseases associated with the abnormality of this acetylcholine. Okay, so what it does is the body convert acetylcholine esterase will convert this acetylcholine into choline and acetic acid. So one side product what you are getting is acetic acid. So if you have acetic acid in the medium, that will lower the pH of the system, right? So sensing of this acetylcholine is very important. So we decided to use this system with the graphene. So here the advantage of our system is we have a graphene. So in the graphene, you can have this type of enzymatic reactions on the surface. You can immobilize these type of enzymes on the big sheet of graphene. So then we have tried this system on the graphene sheet, and when we added the analyte, that is acetylcholine, the enzyme can act on the graphene that will convert acetylcholine to choline and acetic acid, and you can sense acetic acid. Once you have acetic acid in the medium, then the pH will lower, so that will lead to the enhancement of fluorescence. Okay, so by this way, we used this technique to like fluorescent turn on sensing for acetylcholine. Okay, so this is the one application of that material. And the another area we use this material is called photodynamic therapy. This is actually an emerging treatment technique for cancer and other related diseases. And this technique is like, it involves combination of light, photosensitizer, and molecular oxygen. So I will tell you, like, you should have some drug that we call as a photosensitizer. Okay, once you inject into the body, it can go to the different cells, like if you have a tumor cells, so it can accumulate on the tumor cells. And what you have to do is you have to irradiate that portion with some visible light. Okay, you don't have to use radiations, like harmful radiation. You just use laser light. So the light, what this is the things which is happening here. So the photosensitizer, it's at the ground state. It will absorb the light and it will go to the excited state. Okay, it's called a singlet excited state. From the singlet excited state, these drugs or the photosensitizer that can cross over to the triplet state. And from the triplet state, what it can do is the triplet energy can be transferred to a molecular oxygen. You know, we have molecular oxygen in our body, right? So this molecular oxygen is in, it's in triplet form. Okay, once you have the triplet energy, it can go to the singlet state. Oxygen will convert from triplet state to the singlet state. Okay, so that is what the photosensitizer does in the body. So once you have singlet oxygen in the system, this is not like triplet oxygen. Okay, this is highly reactive. So this can attack your different components in your cell, and especially in the cancer cell, and that will initiate the cell death. Okay, eventually the cell will die. So you don't have to use harmful radiation for inducing cell death. You just need to give proper radiation in the visible range. So that's the advantage of this technique. The like side effects are really low. It's highly specific, and it is effective in mainly it's used for skin cancers. And nowadays they are using for various other types of cancer also. And toxicity is very less compared to other treatment. So this is a highly emerging technique. And this is how we used this for PDT applications. And we used the small sheets. You can see it's a very small, it's called graphene condensates. I already showed you. And it has got the fluorescent property. Okay. And but we attached some, this is called body pi derivative. Okay. Again, we used some covalent technique to functionalize these type of molecule on the surface of the graphene sheet. Okay, and we characterized with various techniques. And the property of this molecule is like, it is shows very good singlet oxygen generation. If you radiate with suitable light, it can introduce, it can generate a lot of singlet oxygen. And this molecule is not soluble in water. That's a biggest problem to use in PDT applications. But once you have conjugated with these type of nanomaterials, this total system will become highly soluble in water. Okay, so it's a highly efficient technique. And there are other advantages. Once you have attached to this type of nanomaterial, and this nanomaterial has some emission property, so you can track in the cell where it is located and how it's effective, and you can track the system. And same time, it's highly efficient in killing the cancer cells. And we used in like breast cancer cells. And this material shows very good cell like phototoxicity. It shows very high toxicity in presence of light. Okay, but if you don't have light, it's not that toxic. It's actually toxicity is very less. But if you have light, then it shows very high toxicity. And at the same time, you can see the cells. These are the like cell studies, which shows the fluorescence from the cells. And if you have light, irradiated with light, it's after PDT. Okay, treatment, cells are undergone cell death. Okay, that's what. And the best thing here is the IC50 value is in 30 nanomolar. That means that shows that you need very small amount of these materials to induce cell death in like cancer cells. Okay, so that's a very good thing. And also we used this MOS2 for the same purpose. Like as I mentioned, MOS2 also shows similar properties, and you can make into the small sheets of MOS2 that also gives the fluorescent property in different range, but still you can use this type of material. And this also shows very good like biocompatibility. Studies shows that it's also very highly biocompatible. And we have conjugated, like we used a different chemistry here to conjugate. And this also we used for cancer cells to see how it active in the PDT conditions. And it shows even lesser IC50 value. That means you need very small amount, like even lesser than the graphene derivative for inducing cell death in the cancer cells. Okay, So this is the another area we explore this, the property of this material for some biological applications. Okay, with that, yeah, the important question here is like, can graphene take part in the fight against COVID-19? It's a very relevant question, right? Because it has got various like properties which can be used in various type of sensing applications and some medicinal applications. So the question is, can it be used for like fight against COVID-19? Answer is yes. As I already mentioned, you can use it in air filters. Nowadays, people are using these graphene-based air filters in many areas, especially in big hospitals and all. They used this type of air filters, and already they are using in masks. Okay, then there are a lot of things are going on in the sensing field, like how this material can be used for efficient sensing of this diagnostic purpose and drug screening. We can think about like drug delivery system using these type of materials, and there are a lot of researches going on. Let's hope that this type of materials will be in the market soon. Like scientists will come up with some of the real applications of these materials in more areas. Okay, so yeah, with that, yeah, this is actually about the work I'm doing right now. I'm just skipping these things. So I think I have taken almost more than an hour now. So yeah, so actually I use this opportunity to thank Dr. Joshi Joseph, my PhD grad, and also I thank my present supervisors, Nicholas Vihard and Gary B. Schuster. And also I thank Professor Mohammad Iqbal, principal of institute, and also Professor Sahil sir and HOD, and Dr. Danesh, my friend Danesh, for giving me this opportunity to talk today in this seminar. So, and also I thank everyone for patient listening. Thank you so much. And you can ask any questions if you have. Thank you.
Good morning, all. So if you are having any doubts regarding the topics, am I audible?
Yes.
Okay. So if you are having any doubts regarding the topic, the participants can drop the questions on the chat box, so that our research person can clarify it.
Yeah, sure. You are free to ask any questions, okay? Any of this field, you can ask any questions. Okay, stop sharing. Yeah.
Sir, there is actually one question in the chat box. Can you please hear that?
Yeah, sure. I'll start from the beginning. Okay, one question is graphene water soluble, right? Then how can we use it for, okay, water filtration purpose? Yeah. Yeah, that's a very interesting question. So actually, the solubility of water, the graphene solubility actually depends. So as I mentioned, the pristine graphene, just the pure form of graphene, that is actually not water soluble. Okay, you need some different organic solvent to soluble. Like it's not insoluble in almost all solvents, especially in water. So the graphene forms which use for this type of application is the pure graphene with some defects on it. Okay, so that is not at all water soluble. Only the form which is water soluble is like graphene oxide or other forms. Like if you introduce some oxygen functionalities or other things on the graphene, then it will become water soluble. Okay, any of these forms like pure graphene or other, the one with induced surface defects, these are actually insoluble in water, and you can definitely use for these water filtration purposes. Yeah. Yeah, there is another question. Okay, Geo can only be get as liquid form from Hummus method. Yeah. Yeah, this is another interesting question. Like, definitely, like that's a solution phase technique, right? So it's like you're taking the graphite and dissolving in some solvent, and you are, especially in water, you can do, and you are using this oxidation method technique on that. And definitely you will get in the like dissolved form in the mixture. And if you really want to make it dry, definitely you can try some drying techniques to get, like, you will get a real powder of this graphene sheet. So it's very easy. Definitely it will be in the dissolved form, but you can make it like powder. It's easy to do that. Yeah, another question is like, for electrochemical application, which is the best one, GEO or RGO? Yeah, that's again, like, that's a very good question. Like, that also again depends. Okay, this electrochemical application, mainly people use these techniques for sensing applications. There are a lot of work in that field. If you just search graphene-based electrodes or graphene-based electrochemical sensing techniques, then you will get a lot of papers. Usually they use graphene oxide in that case. Like, again, it's because of you have different defects and oxygen functionality. So you will have different potential oxidation or reduction potential you can get. So, but both are used. Some cases they used RGO-based electrodes for various sensing applications. Actually, that depends on which property you are looking for. Both are used in this field, especially in the electrochemical applications. Any other questions?
Okay, thank you, Anjali, Sabina Jahan, and Hasna Bint Umar Kuti for asking questions. So if anyone, any others having doubt, you may ask now.
Thank you, Sridhar sir. I'm principal.
Okay.
Actually, I'm not a, not from chemistry, but let me ask one question.
Yeah, sure.
That this graphene oxide, we are using for that sensing of some, poisonous gases and etc., right?
Yes.
So means I think a lot of equipments and devices are there to sense.
It's already there in the market. Yes, yeah. Sir. Right.
So what is the latest development in that area? Do you have any idea about that?
Mainly that's a, like, there are a lot of research is going on in that field, especially sensing of ammonia and carbon monoxide, and many things can be detected on this type of material. So this is, technique is a little bit different. Mainly they use, it's a FET, actually field effect transistors. They introduced this type of material in the field effect, like electrode. And I should say, like, any gas that even, I think it's in even PPM level, you can detect using this type of material. So there is a lot of research. I don't know the recent things. I haven't gone through the recent, but there is a lot of people are working on that, especially for ammonia sensing.
So a lot of chances are there.
It's a, this this field is like, there's a lot of business opportunities also there.
And also it's interdisciplinary. I think it's related to electronics, chemistry, and nanotechnology, both. All are interrelated, right?
Exactly. Even biology is also connected. Yeah, biology, right? Is also all type of scientists are working in this field. So can use this in any type of areas.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Attention, please. Our feedback form is now available on our chat box. So those who fill the feedback form will be provided with e-certificates. So I think our session has completed in a successful manner. Now it's the time to wind up our session. So thank you, sir, for giving your valuable insights on the topic two-dimensional nanomaterial for biomedical application. On behalf of Viras College, PG Department of Chemistry, and the entire team, a very hearty vote of thanks for Dr. Srijit Mangalat, sir, for gracing your important work and sharing with us your findings and opinions today. So finally, I would like to thank all the participants who has participated in this session and made this session a successful one. So once again, I'm telling that a feedback form is available on our chat box, so that the e-certificates will be provided only for those people who will fill the feedback form. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Sweet sir means our chemistry students will be in touch with you.
Yeah, sure. Okay. Anytime they can contact me. Thank you so
much.
Dr.
Srijit. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
We'll meet again.
Yeah, sure. See you. Yeah, bye everyone.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your valuable time. Thanks a lot.
Yeah, thanks a lot. Yeah, see you.